Part 5, Helter Skelter. Charlie's evasive about Helter Skelter today.
He's a convict, living in a world of hard-nosed convicts. He's notorious enough to get away with the swastika carved on his forehead, the evil guru murderer who bent the minds of a horde of pretty young girls, can be allowed the odd eccentricity. But a crackpot, who thought the end of the world was coming, and something like Willy Wonka's magic chocolate factory lay waiting for him in a cave under Death Valley? No, the prison population wouldn't offer much respect to such a figure. So Manson today says Helter Skelter may have existed in Susan Atkins' tiny, spaced-out mind, but he never believed or promulgated any such nonsense. There's some evidence that he did, however. It all started with the Beatles. Manson was not only keen to emulate their material success, he appreciated their music too. He bought their records as they came out and studied the lyrics, for it was as a freaky, occulty lyricist that Charlie himself hoped to score, grunging up the healthy, outdoorsy, surf-and-snatch rock of the Beach Boys. And he started to suffer from a delusion common to many Beatles fans. He thought the Fab Four were addressing him personally. Now, this was part of the lad's great appeal to teenagers at the height of Beatlemania. When they made their stunning public appearances, many of the little girls who screamed and squealed and wet their knickers did so under the delusion that their chosen mop-headed idol had seen them and was singing directly and personally to them. It's a useful platform gift, not peculiar to rock singers. I once saw a stripper at the Leeds City Varieties with the same skill. She scanned the audience with big, gleaming, wet blue eyes, and almost every man in the house thought she was ogling him as an individual, and paid that much more attention to her otherwise not very inspiring act. But the Beatles carried this gift over into their lyrics, which, as they grew more imaginative and surreal, seemed to carry a personal meaning for individual fans who were sure they'd worked out the true message or taken in some subliminal content. For the family, this process started at the end of 1968 with the not especially successful Magical Mystery Tour. Charlie listened over and over again to the zanily inspired words of I Am the Walrus and started to believe that he and he alone could interpret them properly. The family's converted school bus was renamed the Magical Mystery Tour, and the family awaited a new Beatles album with the thrilled reverence of a million other young people. When it came, it was that extraordinary, flawed masterpiece, the untitled double white album. And behold, it spake unto the family. There were pieces like Biggies, which, with a deft wit the earnest hippies could never have matched, echoed the alternative society's hostility to the bourgeoisie and its police protectors. But there was one piece that Susan Atkins was sure was consciously addressed to her, Sexy Sadie, for was she not Sadie Mae Glutz? In fact, Sexy Sadie was really aimed at the Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, who had badly disappointed his rock star disciples the previous year when he made passes at their women. John Lennon couldn't bring himself to call the piece Maharishi. Sexy Sadie gave the same scansion, but the words, "What have you done? You made a fool of everyone," confirm the original intention. The song is more hostile than admiring. You'll get yours yet, however big you think you are. And disenchantment with the figure the world was waiting for, who broke the rules and let everyone down, is the keynote. But Sadie Mae Glutz was impervious to such niceties. A song by the Beatles spoke to her. She was the greatest. The Beatles' messages really were addressed to the family. The others agreed, and they found their biggest message in the next track, Helter Skelter. This wonderful, surging, pulsating piece of music, evoking the hectic, carnally charged excitement of teenagers out at the funfair, should never have been connected with Manson's horrible bloodbath. But the insistent questions and answers could be seen as Manson, the supernal sex guru, tantalizing and controlling the yearning little peach fishes of his family. Do you, don't you want me to love you, coming down fast from miles above you? And do you, don't you want me to make you, coming down fast, but don't let me break you? And the descriptive lines, which, like the thrilling bass guitar descending scales and ascending and descending glissandos, place the whole excitement in the fairground, were lost on the family. For a slide circling round a tower is not called a helter-skelter in America. Manson's little girls found mystery in the scene-setting words. When I get to the bottom, I go back to the top of the slide, and I stop and I turn and I go for a ride till I get to the bottom where I see you again. Exotic magic in the recurrent helter-skelter, coming down fast. And the exciting fade-out, fade-in instrumental ending, earning an understandable cry of, I got blisters on my fingers, from the overworked lead guitarist as the music stops, climaxes with cacophony and a clash of cymbals, suggesting the collapse of the environment. Charlie's theology offered an explanation. Pieced together from the dreary arcana of the process, heightened no doubt by elucidatory acid trips, prettified with old Amerindian legends about an underground paradise beyond the waters under the desert, spiced with paranoid tension by Manson's racial fears. This story, given prophetic confirmation by the Beatles, ran that the last great war on earth was soon to break out. It would be a race war, and the aggrieved black man would finally win vengeance over his white tyrants. The bourgeois piggies would all be wiped out, and the black man would rule supreme. But how could he do so? A hewer of wood and drawer of water by nature, he needed some great white master to control him. This was where Charlie, son of man, would step in. For the family would escape helter-skelter, the great race war. Somewhere out in the desert, as the old Indians knew, a deep, deep hole led down to miles of underground rivers and a magic land full of chocolate fountains and other good things. The family would make the ranches at the top of the Gola Wash their desert base and hunt for this hole. They would build up an army of dune buggies to escape through Death Valley when helter-skelter broke out. Protected by loyal gangs of bikers, they would retreat to the magic land under the desert and wait till the black man had conquered the white man. Then, as the victors looked helplessly for a leader to direct the new world order, Charlie would emerge from his subterranean shelter, and man's son would come into his own, graciously accepting the role of king of the world. Did Manson believe this twaddle? Not in his sober moments, I'm sure, but spaced out and excited by the torrid combination of sex, drugs, and rock and roll, he could reel it out with conviction. And the little girls, who really were capable of ineffable silliness, drank it all in. Through 1969, the family shuttled to and fro between Topanga Canyon and Gola Wash. The route into their desert hideout from the west was almost impassable. Even four-wheel, all-terrain vehicles had to stop and wait while great boulders were shifted from their path in the dry wash. To bring the school bus to Barker Ranch, the family had to loop round to the east along desert roads and approach the ranch from deeper in Death Valley. At any given time, there would usually be some members of the family keeping watch over the desert hideout, others in Topanga or at the Spahn Ranch, making bread by drug dealing and putting out. At one point, Charlie thought the girls could earn their fortune as topless go-go dancers, a plan which foundered on the unacceptably small breasts adorning some of the prettiest, and their point-blank refusal to have their mammaries stuffed with silicon. The drug dealing led to the first troubles. A black dealer called Bernie Lotsapapa Crow was loosely associated with them. At times, some of them stayed at his house in Laurel Canyon. It seems that, even before the real trouble began, Charlie was contemplating shooting him. His motive was probably pure racism. He did not want even a useful pusher being described by outsiders as the black member of the family. But it was Tex Watson who apparently kicked off Helter Skelter on Manson's orders by burning Bernie. Tex and a very beautiful girlfriend called Rosina Croner set up Bernie to accompany them to El Monte, where Tex claimed he was going to pick up a big stash. Bernie handed over $2,400 when they reached the appointed house, and Tex went in the front door with it, out of the back door, and back to Spahn with Bernie's money. At 2 a.m. on the 1st of July, a hysterical Rosina telephoned Spahn.
"Charles," she cried, "you got to come back with the money or the grass. Crow's here at my place, and he says he's going to kill me if he don't get his money."
Crow's voice then took over, saying, "Okay, you smart mutter. I got your old lady here, and if I don't get my bread back inside 2 hours, I'm going to cut her up and dump the pieces in your front yard. 2 hours, Watson, or the broad's dead." Manson came to the telephone and explained that he was the other Charles and he hadn't got any bread, but he said he'd come right over and sort things out. He took along a kid named T.J. Wallerman as moral support, and Wallerman took a long-barreled 22 buntline pistol as his moral support. Manson asked Wallerman what he would do if it came to using the gun. T.J. hesitated so long that Manson scoffed that he wouldn't be much use and took it from him. At the apartment, Rosina was tied up on a bed, guarded by two of Crow's white associates. Manson persuaded them to untie her. Crow was furious when he returned. He was a huge man, weighing around 20 stone. Runty little Charlie Manson, at 5'5", couldn't take him on. He tried everything to persuade Crow to let the girl go. He pleaded, he cajoled, he knelt before him. He tried one of his favourite ploys to wrong-foot opponents, inviting Crow to kill him. He held out the gun and urged Crow to shoot him if he must shoot someone. But as Crow reached for it, Manson spun the weapon round in his hand, pointed it at him, and said, "All right, you mother. I begged, kissed your ass, and promised. Now I'm taking the girl out of here, and you can say goodbye to her, me, and your dollars." Lotsa Popper advanced confidently, cursing him. He picked up Manson by the throat, and Manson shot him point-blank through the belly. Lotsa Popper fell to the ground, and Manson, ex-con, petty hustler, and hippie guru, suddenly believed himself to be a murderer. The following day, the newspapers reported that an unnamed Black Panther had been shot with a single bullet and dumped outside a hospital in Los Angeles. Manson was terrified. The helter-skelter nonsense had heightened his paranoid racism as he urged the family on to a summer of fear. But his fear of the armed, disciplined, and determined Black Panthers was real and open. If Lotsa Popper was a panther, then there was a real danger that the brothers would seek revenge. And Charlie the Desert King, whose command dune buggy had been given a fur-lined machine gun mount at the back and a scabbard beside the driving seat to hold the 2-foot sword he had acquired from a Satan slave, had no delusions about his army of barefoot girls, raggle-taggle junkies, and tough bikers if it came to a showdown with the shock troops of Black Power. The family had to post guards at all times. They were to carry arms whenever possible. The advance plans for Helter Skelter were given high priority, including the dotty notion of mapping a special route from Topanga Canyon to Gola Wash in Death Valley with a view to clearing and blasting themselves an escape road. The family started stealing more and more vehicles for cannibalizing and transforming into dune buggies, and increasingly family members found themselves busted on suspicion of auto theft or for credit card fraud. The social work agencies were understandably unhappy about the care of the infants born to some of the women. Manson's first disciple, Mary Brunner, had given him a son, Valentine Michael Manson, named for the hero of the Robert Heinlein science fiction schlock that so impressed Charles. Amazingly, this seems to have been the only conception resulting from Manson's non-stop copulation. Susan Atkins had borne a son whom she named Zosie Zizo Zedfrak and pacified with fellatio rather than gripe water and a dummy. like the loopy grandfather of modern Satanism, Aleister Crowley. Manson's clique carried liberal upbringing a distance that Dr. Spock would not have given his blessing. But it was another drug burn that pushed them down the slide to the final disaster. Bobby Beausoleil had become ever closer to the family. His weak good looks went down well with the sex-obsessed girls, who called him Cupid after one of his film roles. He had brought a new girlfriend, Kitty Lutzinger, into their midst. And he remained their main liaison with the acid-cooking music teacher, Gary Hinman. So it fell to Bobby to deal with the situation when three strong and threatening bikers turned up at Spahn Ranch, claiming that Bobby had sold them poisonous dope prepared by Gary that made them sick. They wanted their money back, $2,000. Bobby and Manson reasonably asked for the remainder of the sample for Gary to test. The bikers said they destroyed the lot. This was a dodgy claim, and suggests that the bikers were trying to burn the family with the threat of force majeure. But Manson and Bobby agreed to approach Gary anyway. Naturally, Gary refused to refund money on acid he couldn't test. No other customers had complained. When Manson telephoned, offering to quiet the bikers, if Gary would hand over a stash worth $2,000 for them, and promising that the family would pay for it later, Gary icily pointed out that they already owed him money. Manson slammed down the phone and muttered, "I'd kill the mother." And seeing Susan Atkins standing around, he said, "Go kill him, Sadie." He does not deny saying it, but declares it was an explosion of temper never intended seriously. Susan says she believed it to be serious. That evening, Bobby, Susan, and Mary Brunner went to shake down Gary Hinman. In spite of their knocking him around, he was fearless and contemptuous, nor could they find goods or money worth $2,000 in his flat to rip off. The three telephoned Charlie, who seized his old sword and rode off in a car with Bruce Davis to terrorize Gary. Gary was still unafraid and shouted at Manson, "It's all you're doing, you phony little bastard! Get out of my house and take these maniacs with you!" Manson's hair-trigger temper, trained by years of abuse in children's homes and prisons, exploded. He lashed out with the sword at Gary, slicing his jaw and ear. Gary remained sensible. As blood dribbled through his fingers, he just said, "Oh, my God, please get out. Can't you understand? I don't have any money. Just go. Leave me alone." Manson and Bruce left, telling the others to make him remember where his money was and clean up his face. 2 days later, Bobby, Susan, and Mary came back to the Spahn Ranch. The news was bad. Gary had started screaming to attract help. To quiet the screaming, Bobby stabbed him, and he died. The only profit from this sordid venture was the papers for Gary's cars, which the family promptly stole. Susan believed a bright idea of hers would throw the police off the scent. Infected by Charlie's paranoia about Black Panthers, she had scrawled "political piggy" in Gary's blood on the wall and left a clenched fist with traced claw marks as a panther's bloody paw print beside it. This, she was sure, would direct the police to investigating the black community. It didn't even make sense to them. Bobby Beausoleil was picked up 4 days later when he was found sleeping in one of Gary Hinman's cars at San Luis Obispo. He could give no good explanation for being in the stolen car of a murder victim, so naturally he was arrested on suspicion of murder. The girls wanted him back. Susan led some of them hopefully on a short skirts and high heels sally to the pavement, hoping that by crude and straightforward hooking they might raise Gary's bail money. No dice. The police were not going to bail the hippie, Satanist, ex-actor, murderer. And so Susan added her pennyworth to the brooding climate of death that was settling over the family, to reach horrific climax in the Tate-LaBianca murders. What about committing a copycat murder to help Bobby?